see for a newly federated nation, influenced by cultures from all around the globe and part of one of the oldest living cultures in the world. The story is full of fascinating characters, political intrigue, grand visions, and most of all, sheer will. Let's take a look at where it all began. An extraordinary human history spanning at least 25,000 years. Indigenous groups gathered here on this plain to feast, to conduct ceremonies, to talk. Its ancient past is still evident today. The name Canberra is thought to have origins in the Ngunnawal language, possibly meaning meeting place. Then Europeans arrived. From the 1820s, more and more of the land was turned into farms. The Canberra region was prime sheep grazing land, and things didn't change much for 50 years. By the end of the 19th century, there was talk of the six British colonies joining together as one nation. The idea was fiercely debated. But after several rounds of voting and lobbying, in 1901, the colonies became one nation under a new constitution.
Any one of 1,000 minor incidences might have deferred federation for years or generations. Its actual accomplishments must always appear to have been secured by a series of miracles.
But it needed a capital, a place to house the engine room of Australia's democracy, the National Parliament. Section 125 of the Australian Constitution stated that this new capital would be located in New South Wales, but at least 100 miles from Sydney. Across the state, locals campaigned passionately for their town to be named the new capital. Eventually, in 1908, the Yass Canberra region was chosen as the ideal site because of its natural beauty, its fresh water, and its security. The job of identifying the perfect site within the region fell to the surveyor Charles Scrivener. The Minister for Home Affairs, Hugh Marn, told Scrivener to
bear in mind that the federal capital should be a beautiful city, occupying a commanding position with extensive views and embracing distinctive features which will lend themselves to the evolution of a design worthy of the object, not only for the present, but for all time.
And so, an area on the Molonglo River was chosen, a canvas ready for a new vision. But what was that vision to be? In 1912, that question was put to the world through an international design competition. There had never been an opportunity like it. Design a capital city for a newly federated nation. It was an architect's dream. 137 entries came in from around the globe. One entry, which showed extraordinary vision, was chosen. An imaginative geometric concept designed by husband and wife team Walter Burley Griffin and Marion Marnie Griffin. A city of boulevards, open gardens and grand monuments, which worked with the bush landscape rather than trying to conquer it, and with a focus on a central triangle for buildings of national significance. The design was chosen, but the city remained nameless. Many names were considered, some lofty.
Ostrobourg.
Paradise.
New London.
Shakespeare.
Maiola.
Eucalyptia.
Some odd.
Kangaroo Mew.
Sid Malat per Brisbane.
But one was chosen. On the 12th of March, 1913, Lady Denman announced the capital's new name.
I name the capital of Australia, Canberra.
A name the area was already known by to those living here. Australia's involvement in two world wars and the effects of the Great Depression kept the new city's progress slow. Some even wanted to move the parliament back to Melbourne. But government bodies, such as the Federal Capital Advisory Committee, and later the Federal Capital Commission, kept working on the city. Parks were created, streets were laid, and trees, carefully chosen by horticulturalist Charles Weston, were planted throughout the city.
Today, we are rejoicing in Canberra's beautiful trees. In my heart is a feeling of gratitude to him. The parks and gardens of Canberra will be his lasting monument.
The Molonglo was dammed, and Lake Burley Griffin began to fill. The Parliamentary Triangle, a symbol of democracy, continued to be punctuated with national buildings and institutions, including Australian Parliament House, opened in 1988 at the Triangle's apex on Capitol Hill. Today, the Griffin's design philosophies continue to guide Canberra's evolution. There have been countless debates, discussions, arguments, and decisions. But most of all, there's been an unwavering determination to see the grand vision of Canberra realised. The transformation of grazing land with an ancient human history into a city which still exhibits that grand vision today. And you are sitting right in the heart of it.